And log in on our guest Wi-Fi. Password, we welcome all, with the first words capitalized, all one word. And if you're on social media, just let folks know that you are here. Regarding today's participation, this is going to be streamed live on our Facebook feed. So if you go to First Federated Church page and like it, you will be able to access it later. Okay, so don't worry about recording something specifically of your son or daughter up here doing something. Okay, we'll have it there for you. I mean, feel free to go ahead and do that anyway, but you'll be able to send it to whoever you know. Okay, I want to turn things over to the scouts now, and thank you so much for being here today.
Congregation, please rise. Color guard, advance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. James?
Holy One, watch over us as we begin this day. Protect us as we live in your care. Send your Holy Spirit to inspire us to sing your praises. Serve your creation. We are your children and only wish to please you. We thank you for your love. Amen.
Amen. More than welcome to sing with us this morning. You know the songs.
He is exalted, the King is exalted. Thank you. is exalted on high.
It's good that you guys be with us here today. We really appreciate it. This next song we're going to do, I know anyone over the age of 30 knows this song.
20.
Okay, 20. Go ahead and sing with us.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
How are you guys doing? Yeah, glad everybody's here today. Snow didn't keep you away. That's good. Glad to see that. Nobody's carrying any germs today, are they? I don't know. We're all kind of walking pathogens when you think about it. Yeah. That's a little bit what today's story is about in the Bible with Jesus. There's Simon Peter's mom was feeling sick. And she had a fever. And so Jesus went in and touched her, and boom, it was gone. How do you know when you have a fever? Yeah, somebody tell me. How do you know?
You feel bad.
You feel bad. Okay, you don't feel right.
Your temperature?
Your temperature. What's that?
Around 100.
Oh, so if you're 100, you have a temperature. No. Yes. Somebody else help me out here. I don't know if I'm sick. How do I know? Okay, what's your temperature supposed to be? Anybody know? Come on, some of you guys had that in school so far. Yeah. 98.6. There we go. Very good answer. But you know what? That's not everybody. My normal temperature is 97.5. If my temperature is 98.6, I'm sick. Isn't that weird? Yeah. Yeah, so not everybody is exactly the same. You might have an actual lower normal body temperature. But it doesn't matter, right? You just get up and go do whatever you're supposed to do anyway, right? You go to school when you're sick, right? Make everybody else in the classroom sick.
Well, basically,
in
school, if you are sick, well, you're supposed to skip a day because you don't want to come to school because you don't want to get other people sick.
Really? Mm-hmm. That's a really nice thing. If people would just stay home when they're sick. If they would just stay home, a lot of other people wouldn't get sick, would they? Yeah, yeah. But people don't do that. People got to go to work. They got to go to work and get everybody else sick. Yeah. And then wait till summer. Yeah, right. Yeah. Jesus came in, touched Simon Peter's mother, and made her feel better so that she could get back up and do the things that needed done. Now, we could deep into that story and find out that, is that really what we're talking about here? That Jesus just made this, actually Simon Peter's mother-in-law, I keep on saying mother, his mother-in-law, that he made her feel better just so she could get up and fix them lunch. Yeah. It's quite a bit more complicated than that. Jesus touches us so that we can get up, but so that we can serve. And that's what we're going to be talking a little bit about in today's message. Well, I'm just going to offer us up a word of prayer. And anybody that's here from First Federated that's going to go back to Kids Church, you're going to be welcome to do that as soon as I do the prayer. So just listen to this prayer, if you would, please. Holy God, we thank you that we could be here this morning, that we're all feeling well. And we pray for those times when we are feeling sick, not just when we have a fever, but those times when we feel a little bit sick inside. Come and touch us and help us feel better. Help us be healed so that we can serve in the ways that you would have us serve. And we all say, amen. Great. Thanks, Kevin.
Woke up this morning feeling mighty low. Alarm clock was buzzing, didn't want to go.
See you.
the pain. Come soak this dry heart with healing rain. And only you, the Son of Man, could take a leper and let him stand. So lift your hands, let them be held by someone greater, the great I am. Healing rain, it comes with fire, so let it fall and take us higher. Healing rain, I'm not afraid to be washed in heaven's rain.
Dusty's going to come up here and offer our prayer for us this morning, and Dusty Jacobs. And in our time of prayer today, I'd like to add to our list of prayers, Dewey Clark. I forgot to get him on our bulletin prayer list this week. Dewey was Cub Master many years ago and a member of our congregation, so our prayers for Dewey and his family. Okay, all yours.
O Creator, whose voice I hear on the winds and whose breath gives life to all the world, hear me. I stand before you, one of your many children. I am small and weak. I need your strength and wisdom. Let me walk in beauty and make my eyes ever behold the red and purple sunsets. Make my hands respect the things you have made. My ears strive to hear your voice. Make me wise so that I may know the things you have taught all people, the lessons you have hidden in every leaf and walk. I seek strength, God, not to be superior to others, but to be able to fight my worst enemy, myself. Make me ever ready to come to you with clean hands and straight eye, so that when life fades as the fading sunset, my spirit may come to you without shame. Amen.
Let's join together in this prayer for right conduct. Give us clean hands, clean words, and clean thoughts, O God. Help us to stand for the hard right against the easy wrong. Save us from habits that would harm. Teach us to work as hard and play as fair in your sight alone. Forgive us when we are unkind, and help us to forgive those who are unkind to us. Keep us ready to help others at some cost to ourselves. Send us chances to do a little good every day, and so to grow more like Christ. Amen. Jonathan.
Directly on leaving the meeting place, they came to Simon and Andrew's house, accompanied by James and John. Simon's mother-in-law was sick in bed, burning up with fever. They told Jesus. He went to her, took her hand, and raised her up. No sooner had the fever left than she was fixing dinner for them. That evening, after the sun was down, they brought sick and evil-affected people to him. The whole city lined up at his door. He cured their sick bodies and tormented souls. Because the demons knew his true identity, he didn't let them say a word. While it was still night, way before dawn, he got up and went out to a secluded spot and prayed. Simon and those with him went looking for him. They found him and said, "Everybody's looking for you." Jesus said, "Let's go to the rest of the villages so I can preach there also. This is why I've come." He went to the meeting places all through Galilee, preaching and throwing out the demons.
Thank you, Jonathan. Now, this may not be true for every household, but I want you to think back to your childhood, however long ago that was, even if it's today. Recall, if you can, a time when your mother or whoever it was that took care of you got sick with a cold or the flu. What happened? Your house got turned upside down, didn't it? In some homes, I bet things came to a screeching halt. Food didn't get properly prepared. Lunches went unpacked. School fees got paid late. Laundry probably didn't get done at all. No matter how evenly duties are supposed to be distributed in a household, when a chief cook and bottle washer is sick, it's more than inconvenient. Kind of rises to a level 3 snow emergency type thing. How many have had a relative socially klutzy enough to invite company over when a key member of the household was under the weather? Oh, we do have a couple hands. Yeah, it happens, right? I mean, that's Simon Peter in this story. His mother-in-law is sick, but he invites all the guys over. I mean, it's Super Bowl Sunday. Of course he's going to invite all the guys over. Well, what do we do after church, usually? I mean, we eat, right? The pack and the troop are going upstairs to eat after this service. Well, in a Jewish tradition, after synagogue, they break their fast because they haven't had anything to eat since the night before. And they have, usually a meal of various cold, sometimes smoked or pickled foods. Simon brought these guys home for lunch, even though his mother-in-law was sick. Now, we don't know why Simon's wife isn't mentioned. You know, we don't even know his mother-in-law's name. Simon's household doesn't fit the stereotyped unit of one husband, one wife, 2.5 children, their pets, and video games. His mother-in-law not only lives with them, but is apparently in charge of hospitality, which is a role of honor in the Jewish tradition. I mean, we don't really know for sure why she's living with Simon. You know, maybe she had no other male to provide for her, which would have been another thing of the ancient Middle East. Maybe her daughter, Simon's wife, was seriously ill herself, or perhaps even deceased, and Simon needed help in running the household while he was out doing his job of being a fisherman. Simon's mother-in-law is the primary caregiver. Primary caregiver. Those words strike fear and anxiety into the minds of most adults, primarily because of the responsibility that goes with those two words. The primary caregiver is the first and perhaps the only person who virtually gives up their life to assist someone else. Maybe even to the extreme, to provide the necessary care to keep someone else alive. When my sons and I went to Philmont, that's the Boy Scout High Adventure Base out in the Rocky Mountains of New Mexico, at least one adult of every crew had to be certified in wilderness first aid. I don't know why I was chosen. Maybe it's because I lived the farthest away from the training center. I don't know. Had to drive up to Painesville for this stuff. But anyway, we reviewed the typical stuff that is learned for first aid merit badge, plus other things that would be unique to the wilderness experience. Bear attacks were unlikely, but a possibility. Rattlesnake bites as well. Evan came within 3 feet of being bitten by a rattlesnake on our last day. Falling presented the most likely danger, from tripping over an obstacle while carrying a 40-pound pack to making, you know, an unscheduled descent off a cliff. If a person fell, we were to check out the four quadrants of the torso to determine any internal injuries. Our instructor explained how to check these spots and then matter-of-factly stated, "And if this is wrong, you're gonna die." Just like that. It became our running joke in class as we took turns diagnosing the victim. "You're gonna die." Of course, in real life, it's not hilarious, but it was how we got through class. Out there in the wilderness, it's possible to be days away from even the most basic assistance. It would take a miracle to survive. Simon's mother-in-law had a fever. Today we take some aspirin. Back then, maybe she needed a miracle to survive. I mean, we know how serious a fever can be in the present day, especially when it starts getting creeping up there past 101. The flu's a real worry this time of year, right? We've had many of the healthiest people among us get sick. And we don't think of modern medicine so much as a miracle. We just expect it to work. What is our expectation of Jesus? And Jesus touched the woman, and what happened? She was raised up. Well, chauvinists think this story is about woman serving and being subservient to men. It is impossible to be more incorrect. In Christian terms, this story means that she was resurrected. She was given a new life with the purpose to serve Jesus in the ways that Jesus empowers all of us to serve. Everybody in the world is searching for happiness. Want to know how to find it? The famous educator Booker T. Washington said, "Those who are happiest are those who do the most for others." Something our leaders certainly understand. That is what Jesus is teaching in this healing. Happiness is what happens when you let Jesus touch you. Are you expecting a miracle? Now, we pray every week for people with very real physical and spiritual needs. What is it that you need? Are you going to let Jesus touch your heart? Now, Jesus can touch us at any time, and that touch may inspire us to serve in a way that we've never served before. For the members of our congregation, it might be coordinating the Sunday hospitality area. It could be helping to set up for our church banquet in a couple of weeks, or even more importantly, cleaning up afterwards. It could be committing to serving on a board or a committee wherever you go to church. For parents, it could mean committing to more than just dropping off and picking up your child for their various activities. That touch may lift us to a place of experience that we could never have known had it not been for letting Jesus into our lives. It is important for children to see their parents involved much as our leaders are, and being involved in their lives to a certain extent. But it's even more important for children to be involved in service to others themselves, especially in ways that don't directly benefit them. Jesus said, if you only love the lovable, do you expect a pat on the back? If you only help those who help you, do you expect a medal? If you only give for what you hope to get out of it, do you think that's charity? No. Even sinners do that. It's in the book of Luke. Everybody arranges their schedules to accommodate the things that we want to do. I dare your phone to ring at 6:30 this evening and you're going to answer it. Especially when you look and say, I'm not talking to them. It's kickoff time. Are we willing to give up our free time to help a neighbor, a total stranger, even a foreigner who is in need? Florence Nightingale, maybe you've studied about her in school. She was the famous English nurse that served on the battlefield in the Crimea, I believe. She said, if I could give you information of my life, it would be to show how a woman of very ordinary ability has been led by God to do in his service what he has done in her. You would see how God has done all. I have worked very hard, very hard. That is all. And I have never refused God anything. Who knows how many men, mostly, got their second chance at life because Florence Nightingale responded to being touched by Jesus. How will you respond in this fever of life when you are touched by Jesus? Amen.
Offer themselves and expect nothing in return.
Dylan's next.
Good morning. My name is Dylan. Thank you so much for being here this morning. Each week we take a few minutes and worship God through our giving and generosity. While the scouts prepare to receive our offering, I want to share a quick thought with you about giving. Giving is never about guilt. Some churches have done an excellent job of making people feel guilty to get them to give money. Their church and any true church will never be about that. Here's why. Guilt makes people bitter, not better. The true church wants something for you, not something from you. We want you to experience the life that Jesus promised in John 10:10. I came to give life, life that is full and good. We refuse to motivate through guilt. Instead, we want to give focus on God's goodness. The reason we give isn't to keep God from getting mad at us. It's because we're so thankful for what God has done for us. Jesus laid his life down on the cross so that we may experience life. Let's give out of gratitude today. Let's give out of an understanding of God's goodness. Every week, when you give your offering in your church, give out of an overflow of that goodness in our lives. And let's give so that we may have a life that is full and good. Thank you.
Two more.
Because of the National Honor Society, and just because they like to see the happiness that it brings other people. Just joy.
Where's our helper?
Let it stop. Just pray to everyone. Now it's up to you. There's something you can do. Give more love. Give more love. Give more love. So many times when hearts are broken. So many angry words get spoken. Let's all try to understand. Reach out a helping.
They know coming in here that if they weren't here, they would not be able to have food to eat or food to feed their families or food to make Christmas dinner. And we just have people hug us all the time and say, you guys really don't understand how much we appreciate this, and everybody's really appreciative. What we're doing is important, and it's really helping people who really need it.
There's something you can do. Give more love. 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 Give more love.
Randy's going to read the offering prayer, I think, right? Do I have the right name? Randy Reese, I think?
Yeah.
Yeah, come on up. Yep. And you can stay right here for a second. There you go. You can hop right up on there. There you go.
God of all that is all we have, all we are, we give these gifts as we reach across the limits of our conquerors. We give these gifts knowing that they will give so much more through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good job. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, while the praise team makes their way back up here, just going to look in the bulletin for our announcements. And, of course, if you're buying flowers for Easter, I can't believe we're talking about that already, but there's a little form in there, and there's a hard deadline on that. So those have to be in on time. And there's an interfaith tea that is on this Tuesday at St. Columbus. It's at 1:30. Anybody wants to carpool, be here at 12:30. And Brewing Faith continues tomorrow at noon. Anyone is invited. Bring a snack, bring lunch. Coffee's always on. And we talk about some really good topics. We've been doing, actually, our Are You Smarter Than a Seventh Grader? The adults are doing our confirmation class. So that's been just been a hoot for me. So anyways, that's just some things going on. Go ahead and take that home. Share it with somebody. Please, let's stand. We're going to sing.
My Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I'll never be the same, 'cause you came near. From the everlasting to the watery land, Father's only Son. If you lived, if you died, if you rose again on high, if you opened the way for the world to live again, hallelujah, for all you've done. My Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty Father, I'll never be the same, 'cause you came near. From the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. And you lived, and you died, and you rose again on high. And you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah, for all you've done. 'Cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. Lord we love, the Father's only Son. And you lived, and you died, and you rose again on high, and you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah, for all you've done. Hallelujah, for all you've done.
Amen.
May God bless and keep you. May Jesus' face shine through yours. And may the Holy Spirit inspire you to do good things you never knew were possible. Amen.